Well, good morning, church. Welcome to the wonderful house of the Lord this morning as we gather together to worship the Lord. Just want to mention in the way of announcements just a little bit here. And one is that we just got through going through five lessons that were pretty difficult to go through or controversial topics. And a lot was said in those things. And some of you may have questions. And next Sunday, we're going to have the elders are going to be here, and we're going to answer your questions. However, we need those to be written out in advance for us. So sometime this week, either through email or through writing out, give us your questions that you have on any of those topics that we gave you in Sunday school. It's not just for any topic in the world, right? Just those that was on during the Sunday school. So we would appreciate that, and we're going to go through that on our Sunday school class next Sunday. Also, notice the handout in there for the Sunday school classes that's coming up. It's important that you come to Sunday school classes because we are in the Word of God during those periods of time. So this is what's going to be in there. We're going to talk more about that next week. I want to thank you, those that signed up for the nursery. We had a good response on those. We got more people being active in that, and we appreciate it. And I believe that's all.
So before we start our service this morning, we're going to have just a little bit of time to do some testimonies. So Honor's going to go first. These are testimonies for the summer that we had at camp. So Honor and I were the ones sent from Southeast Valley. So enjoy.
I'm Honor, and I served as a wrangler at Grandview Camp this summer. And I really learned that it's through God that we are showing God to campers. And it's not through anything that we do. So during staff training, there was a cold that went around, and I, being prideful, was like, oh, I never get sick, I'll be fine. Even if I do get sick, it'll just be a little thing, right? So I get to about midway through the summer, and I got pretty sick. I wasn't reaching my full potential of how I wanted to work or anything. So it was stressing me out. I was tired. I didn't want to do trail rides anymore. So I go on a trail ride one week, and I didn't talk to anybody. I was just miserable and self-pitying. And I go on the trail ride, and we get back. There's this one kid on the trail ride, and he's always stressed. You could tell he was tense. He was worried about his little brother all the time. And we get back from the trail ride, and he had gotten on super tense, and he looked done with everything. And he came back, and he was smiling. And he was smiling really, really big. And you could tell he had a really fun time. And that's when I realized I had done nothing. I had no part in that. Because God had shown his light through me, even though I was a miserable wreck and I wasn't doing anything productive. God had shown his light through me to this camper and helped him have a good time at the summer camp. So, yeah, that's it.
I'll keep my testimonies a little short, but some things that I learned over the summer, one, that God is a very providential God. We saw that a lot with the drought that Arizona was going through. We're up there in the middle of a forest, right? And back in 2011, Arizona's biggest forest fire happened. And we were pretty dry, and we haven't been that dry since 2011. And God, towards the end of the summer, he started bringing just showers of rain, which, one, is a very good thing from all the dryness that we've been having, but two, also can conflict with the summer when we're trying to play games outside, something like that. Well, whenever God brought rain, it was like the exact moment that all the kids were going to go inside anyways. And he brought it, so for instance, one of the things that we do during the summer is all the kids go on a hike. And this is out in the National Forest, it's not on camp property. And the National Forest actually got so bad that they ended up closing it to public use, but we could still function up there. And then God sent rain in time for the National Forest. Those people who were in charge of opening it back up, They opened it up 40 minutes before our hike was supposed to happen, and that was just one of the coolest things that I've seen God do. His timing was absolutely perfect, and every single day he was asking us to trust in him with that. Another testimony that I have is that God has a bigger purpose than we can see. And this happened towards the end of the summer. Me and Peter were getting a little frustrated with how everything was going program-wise, and we were focused on the program games. You know, how do we run this the best way possible? How do we make it fun for the kids? How do we make it fair for the counselors? All that fun stuff. And later that day, randomly I was walking back to the bunkhouse to go get ready for service, and as I was coming back from the bunkhouse to the main lodge, I ran into a camper that, like, no one else was around. His counselor, you know, his counselor was with all of his other campers, and there was no one else out there, and we had a conversation, and he was very distraught. He was very angry at God. He had seen a lot of death in his life, a lot of horrible things, and God, like, our paths did not cross by accident, and I knew that, and it was just an amazing thing, because later that night, like, not because of anything I did, but all because God worked on his heart through the message, through conversations with me as youth pastor, that kid ended up getting saved that day, and told me about it, and it was just like, and it was the same day that I was getting really frustrated about the program stuff. And that's when God made me realize that, man, he has, he's got bigger plans than the game that we play Tuesday morning, you know? Like, camp's not about that. Camp's about the impact that God can make in a camper's life. And that's just such a really, really cool thing. Something that I got to see firsthand. Just to close out, I just want to talk a little bit about some things that are coming up. So I'm leaving on Tuesday to go back up to camp to continue college. This semester is going to be interesting. So one, I just want you all to pray for us, because we're going to have a lot of change this semester. We have 7 students up there, which by comparison, we had 4 last semester. So 7's a lot. And they're going to be younger, some of them. And it's just going to be different how we have to work through things. Peter and I will be more influential in their lives, I guess. Things like that. So school is one thing. Work is another thing. We're going to have a busy retreat season and all of that. But just be praying for us that we can work through it well, that we don't kill each other. because that can be a really big temptation when you live with the same 7 people for a very long time. But God's gracious, and we're trusting in him. So just be praying for us, and I'll be back sometime in November, hopefully, for Thanksgiving break, and then after that, sometime in December. So thanks for your support, by the way, for sending us to camp and all that. We really appreciate that, and we love you very much. It's been fantastic being here again, so we'll see you sometime later.
Amen.
Isaac and Honor, let's give them a round of applause for their work. And you should see her on a horse. It is impressive, and it is very impressive. And I'm in no way, shape, or form tempted at all. It's just amazing. Really appreciate both of these kids. Hey, if you want to make a gift to help them, I know that we're still trying to raise some money for our young people that work at Summer. And so if you want to make a special gift, just throw it in there. The sponsoring staff for camp, we're trying to help both of them. It's Isaac, we're trying to help him finish whatever we can do to help him with his college tuition. It's really a fantastic program where they're doing their Christian college work while they work at a Christian camp. I love that. I love that combination where it's not just academically, but they're actually bridging together the academics of real life ministry. And we want to help them financially. And so as the Lord burdens you to maybe put 100, 200 bucks in, write a check to help them, that would be fantastic. Or if you want to do 1,000 or 2,000, you could do that too. Just write a check, put that in the offering. Thank you, Pastor Jeremy. Yeah.
All right, please stand. Welcome to Southeast Valley Bible Church. It is a privilege to be with you. Let me read Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, including yourself, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If you are in Christ, let me just tell you this, God has loved you with an everlasting love, and he's brought you here to worship with his people. So let's begin our service singing, Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus.
Jesus.
seated.
Please turn to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9. This morning it's our privilege to have communion together, the Lord's table. And here in just a minute, after we share some thoughts and we look at some scripture, we'll pray, and then we'll have row by row here in the front. We'll come up here to the front. And then row by row, the leaders will lead row by row in the back. And we have two cups together. There's the bottom cup has the little wafer, and then the top cup has the juice. Communion is the Lord's table is a special time for the Church of Christ. We're a Bible church. We're an independent Bible church, and so we have folks with all we have folks with all kinds of different backgrounds. sitting next to you. Some of you grew up in a Baptist. Some of you came to Christ out of the Catholic Church, or we have some converted Jews. We have converted Mormons here that came to Christ right out of Mormonism into the faith. We have folks that have a Baptist background. We have folks that have a Mennonite background and Reformed background, and you name it. I mean, it's quite a group together. And so it leads to a lot of diversity, and I think that can be good. A church that's not mature, a lot of diversity is pretty dangerous for the pastor, just to let you know. That could lead to all kinds of infighting, but we don't have that here, and the Lord has been good to us. There's just a great, sweet fellowship, sweet spirit together, and that is how God intended it to be, and there's very few things that we do as a church that's more important and special than what we're ready to do right now. You just got to know this. At Southeast Valley, we would say the communion is just as important. The Lord's table together is just as important as anything else we do. It's just as important as preaching a sermon, just as important as singing, just as important as taking the offering. We don't even take the offering. We got a box in the back, and so you can give as you come in and as you leave. Communion, the ordinance of baptism in the Lord's table, is paramount to our faith. Now, it's not, we don't get to heaven because we partake in juice and the bread. We believe that we're accepted into God's family by faith in Christ. Jesus lived a sinless life. He fulfilled the moral law of God perfectly. He died on a cross for your sin. They buried him. He rose again. He ascended on high into heaven. He's seated on the right hand of the Father. And if we respond to Jesus and Jesus' work in faith and repentance, God forgives us. He gives us new life. We have a relationship with God through his son, Jesus. And it means that we're related together as brothers and sisters, whether you like it or not. We're related to each other. Yeah. And so let me just say, for those of you that are here, and you may not be members at Southeast Valley Bible Church, so let me just say, some churches believe what's called closed communion. You have to be a member in their church to participate in the Lord's table. We don't take that position. We believe what's called close communion. What is close communion? Close communion is if you've trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you're of like faith and belief, then it's okay. If you're not a member of our church, you're a member of the most important church, and that's the church of our Lord. And we are all part of that universal body. And so we don't believe in closed communion. We believe in close communion. And so you are welcome to participate in the juice and the bread together with us. Let's notice Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, as we think about the New Testament economy, Old Testament Israel, man, there was a lot of feasting in the Old Testament. You know that, right? You had Passover. I mean, you had the Feast of Booths. I mean, you had Tabernacles. I mean, it was year-long celebration, and it wasn't just a Sabbath, but it was a Sabbath of Sabbaths. And so there was a year-long system of remembrance and celebration. And so for us in the New Testament, we don't have all of that, but we have this, and this is special. And as a matter of fact, the New Testament church is encouraged to do this as often as you do it in remembrance of me. So this is a special thing. So I'm never put out. I'm never put out when on these Sundays when we have the Lord's table, I try to preach a smaller sermon. I'm never put out to cut off 10 or 15 minutes out of my sermon because, I mean, in some of those Old Testament celebrations, it took them days, if not weeks, to prepare for their celebration. So honestly, 10 or 15 minutes, and if you get to Luby's, 5 minutes late, come on, it's the Lord's table, and it's worth it for us to be willing to be late for that lunch, to not be late on this meal. Hebrews chapter 9, we think about the celebration of what the table reminds us of. Christ came as high priest of the good things to come. With a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation. Not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place, watch this, once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. For the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of the heifer, sprinkling of the unclean, sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through eternal spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And for this reason, he, that is Christ is the mediator of the new covenant, not me, not a pastor, not a guy behind a booth, right? No, Christ is our mediator. Did you know that there are days our Lord hears your prayers before he hears mine? Did you know that? It's true. Listen, if you're in Christ, if you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you have everything you need to have continual fellowship with God the Father through his Son Jesus. Now, having a pastor, having leaders, that's important. Having one another, that's important to encourage one another, to walk with each other, to pray for each other as we're having a hard time. To lean on each other, yeah, that's important. But in Christ, through Christ, we have everything that we have in the new covenant. By means of his death, for the redemption of the transgression, for the redemption of the transgressions under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Turn, if you will, over to the end of Hebrews chapter 9. Let's look at this one more time. Hebrews chapter 9, look at verse 24. For Christ has not entered the holy place made with hands, which are copies of the true, but in heaven itself. Verse 25, not that he should offer himself often as the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood of another. He then would have to suffer often since the foundation of the world. So this is a good reminder for the theology that says, well, in order for me to be saved or be to right with God, I've got to take communion, or I've got to take the table, the cup, and the bread. I've got to take that on a regular basis so I'm regularly covered. No, Jesus covered you once. It was a once-for-all act on his... So really, religion comes down to two. Either it's done or you do. And so those who are focused on, well, I've got to do this, and I've got to partake in this, and I've got to do this so I'm okay. No. That's not the version that we get from Scripture. It's done. Christ did it for us once for all. Look at verse 28. So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time apart from sin for salvation. Man, that's a beautiful reminder. Our Lord is coming back. He's coming back. He came, you know what? He promised he'd come back the first time. Guess what? He came back the first time. The same Lord said he's going to come back a second time. Guess what? He's going to come back a second time. And we know it's soon. We know it's soon. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Say, Joel, how then does that reflect on what we're doing this morning? Notice 1 Corinthians chapter 11, if you would. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, the Apostle Paul says this, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And then verse 26, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. They were busy even in the early church. He knew that we were going to be busy. He knew that we were going to be tempted to have a flippant attitude at the coming of the Lord's table on these opportunities. So that's why he adds verse 27. Therefore, notice verse 27. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. I think it is possible as believers to be flippant about the Lord's table. And there's warning. He's going to go on, verse 28, 29, verse 30. For this reason, some believers amongst you are really suffering. Some are seriously ill and some die. The Lord takes some believers home. That has more to do with a believer not just being flippant about this occasion, but being flippant about his life as he comes to this occasion. And I really believe that there's a significant application in verse 27. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup in an unworthy manner. Now, say, here's the deal. Some people in the early church, when they were partaking of the Lord's table, often the Lord's table was connected with something called the agape feast. That's when the early church would have a potluck, right? And so they would have a meal, and then at the conclusion of the meal, they would break the bread and they would drink the wine. And so some people were getting drunk. They were abusing the wine. Some people were gorging themselves on food, while other people were starving because they were poor. They didn't have food, and that became a real problem in the Corinthian church. And so in that context, Paul is saying, look, as we come to the Lord's table, we just got to be really careful. We got to be careful that, you know, we don't act solemn and serious with our Lord as we take communion, but then the rest of the week we go and we live like the world. God sees that, right? So I'm your pastor. I love you, but I don't live with you. I don't see you 24/7. God the Father sees us 24/7. Okay. Oh. You know, I don't say this because I believe that we as believers should live our life just waiting for God to. This is really handy as a sermon illustration. I don't believe it's right for us to live our life just always fearful that any moment God's going to just crack our skull, right? I mean, some of us grew up in denominations when, like, you're always guilty and you're always wrong and, like, you can never do right and, like, you always come and leave church just under this cloud of retribution. And you know God's about ready to open up the ground like the sons of Korah and then swallow you and burp. And you just know that's you. And you know that. So you live under a cloud of fear. Can I just say this? If that's you, that's not what God does not want you to live under that kind of wrong view of his character. God doesn't want you to be afraid of him in that regard. Here's the deal. All of us sin enough in one day to damn us to hell forever, and we would deserve it. Everybody hear that? Let me say that a little bit stark. You sin enough in one day that it would be righteous for God to send you to hell forever. And so if it was God's style to whack you over the head because of a bad day, you'd already not be here. Me too. Okay. So on the one hand, it's not right. It's not healthy. It's not consistent with Christ. It's not consistent with the gospel for us to be living in fear. I mean, I've heard this. People growing up in church were... The churches don't preach a security of salvation. So there's a wrong application of once saved, always saved. Some people say, well, I said a prayer when I was 3 or 4, and man, I don't really love Christ, and I'm not going to live for him, but once saved, always saved. I'm sorry, that's not the Bible kind of salvation. So you don't get to claim that verse if you don't love and live Christ. On the other hand, it is also true that all of us that love Jesus and have asked the Lord in our life and are following him, all of us have to deal with indwelling sin. It's like that nasty birthmark that we're ashamed of, and it's just like the shadow of that depravity is going to follow us until we're in the glorious light of the presence of Christ. So on the one hand, it's not right for us to be fearing that any moment God's... On the other hand, walking in the fear of God recognizes he is sovereign, he has authority, and one day I will give an account And oh, if I live in rebellion to him, I will have to answer that. Oh, and if I'm his child, he is going to chasten me, and that's his plan. And if I'm God's child, I live in disobedience. You think you can live in disobedience and God's going to allow? No. I mean, Scripture is full of admonition. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens. I think we think of all of that as we come to the Lord's table. I'm your pastor. I love you. I'm happy to pray with you. I'm happy to spend time with you together over discipleship, and I'm happy to do that. But the Lord's table is something more important than even fellowship with the pastor and the person next to you, and that is fellowship with the person of Christ himself and his Spirit. Father, we thank you for this time of communion, this Lord's table. Lord, we reflect powerfully on these gifts. Father, as we come together, we thank you. And we thank you, and not only do we thank you, but we give fresh repentance of our own sin. Not only do we thank you, but we give fresh repentance of the sins of our family. Not only thank you, but we give you fresh repentance for the sins of our congregation. Father, not only do we thank you, but we give fresh repentance for the sins of our nation. Father, not only do we thank you, but we give you fresh repentance for the sins of the world. Father, not only do we thank you, but we give fresh repentance for the sins of your church, your people. Father, I pray especially for my brothers, those who are fathers and husbands. I pray that you would help us, forgive us for not being faithful priests of our homes. Lord, I pray that we would renew that commitment to you today as we gather together under your word, around this holy table, around the bread and around the juice. We pray that you bless this time as we partake together, for it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Paul records, I received from the Lord that the Lord Jesus on that night, the same night he was betrayed, he took bread. They would have had a loaf of unleavened bread. One loaf, ripping it, giving it to person. He gave thanks over it. He broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Well, the scriptures tell us that Jesus took his leaders on a hill, and they sang a hymn. So our musicians will lead us.
Please stand together as we sing "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross," followed by three stanzas of "Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us."
Thank you.
like a shepherd, lead us, march we need thy tender care. In thy pleasant pastures, feed us, for our use thy folds prepare. Blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us thine, we are. Blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us thine, we are. We are thine to thou be
bulletins. Notice this month's catechism before we dismiss the children to Children's Church, sixth grade on down. Once again, this catechism comes from the Anglican Catechism. To be a Christian. Question: what do you know about the unending resurrected life of believers? We'll answer together. I know that it will be an eternal life of joyful fellowship with our triune God, together with all his saints and angels, singing his praises and serving him in the renewed creation. And we'll dismiss all the children, sixth grade and down. Some of you come from church traditions that don't do a catechism, so you might wonder, well, why do we do a catechism here? Because the majority of the 2,000-year historic church has done catechism, and so just because maybe our individual experience has not been that. The wider historic church has appreciated the role of catechism. And so we borrow unashamedly from Westminster, Augustinian, the Baptist, Spurgeon's catechism. We borrow from quite a few. If you'd like a sermon outline, please raise your hand. We have a sermon outline. We're going to finish, God willing, what we started last week. And as we hand out those sermon outlines, I just want to, I really appreciate the work that was put into this this little pamphlet that's in your bulletin. I pray that you'll take a look at that. Notice in our Sunday school, in our Sunday schools, we have four different tracks. We have a Bible track, a history theology track. We have a Christian living track and a starting point. And so those are the different tracks of Sunday school that we have. And I really love the history, number two, history and theology. I really enjoy those. But the rest of these are good as well. And so I probably should have said I like these equally, but I'd be lying. And so history and theology is really, I mean, I love the scriptures as well. Christian living, starting point, that's all good. But I have a particular interest in the historical and theological section, and so that'll be fun. First Peter chapter 5, this morning, as I kind of hinted to during our communion, is a shorter than normal sermon. We started last week, and last week we noted 16 elements in verses in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1 through 5. And let's just read this passage again, and we'll kind of pick up where we left off, and then we'll be done. It'll be a short service today. The elders who are among you, I exhort, I who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed, shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, nor as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being an example to the flock, that when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Verse 5, likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders, yes, all of you, be submissive to one another and be clothed with humility, for God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Last week we noted, by way of introduction, this opening quote that comes from B.B. Warfield. A minister must be learned on pain of being utterly incompetent for his work, but before and above all learned, a minister must be godly. Nothing could be more fatal, however, than to set these two things against each other. That is to say, Warfield is simply explaining that in order to be called and to function as a pastor, as a shepherd, as an elder, it requires that he knows God's word, but it also requires that he walks with God. And so, and we said last week that if you actually take a close look at the requirements of what it means to be a pastor, you'll actually find out that all those other requirements are also passed on to those that are believers who God has called into secular work, not to serve as a pastor, maybe not even as a deacon, but God is desirous of all of us to be able to say that these character traits are true of each one of us in our life. Notice the second paragraph we noted last week. The right kind of biblical leadership matters in his church. We talked about this morning in Sunday school, and if you missed Sunday school, we're happy to give you some notes. I think you can actually, we can give you a place where you can go on our church website and listen to the very Sunday school classes that we've looked at in the last 4 or 5 weeks. And by the way, I hope that next week that you will, this week, if you have questions based on our discussions in Sunday school on sexuality, marriage, gender, transgender, we've talked about a lot of different controversial subjects the last 4 or 5 weeks. I pray that if you have some questions that you'll actually follow what Pastor Jeremy had said and you'll send us a question so that we can deal with those. But as we've been talking the last month or so about godliness in marriage, and especially for his children, and especially for leaders who are pastors and deacons, here Peter is giving a powerful summary. Now, we said last week that really 1 Peter 1 through 5 falls in a wider section from 1 Peter 5, verse 1 through 11. Those first 11 verses, these are really specific instructions to those who are to lead the church. Now, I'll repeat myself somewhat from last week. And if you weren't here last week, I hope that you'll go back and you'll listen to that sermon. We went deep into a lot of detail that we're not going to do today. We're going to kind of just land the plane today. A lot of the sermon was anchored from last week. But we noted, as we saw in Acts chapter 28, we saw it in James chapter 5, we see it here in 1 Peter chapter 5. In the New Testament, you have three primary terms that speak of the office of pastor. He is, first of all, an elder. And you'll notice, last week we noted that something like 57 times or 58 times the word elder shows up. It's in the plural. 4 times it shows up in the singular. 17 times individual churches were said to have been led by an elder team, elders. And so we see this pattern of plurality. So first of all, the first title given to the pastor office is elder. It means that he's risen to a certain rank of maturity. It doesn't mean he knows it all. It certainly doesn't mean that he has no more to grow. But he's not a novice. He is mature. He's lived a section of his life in the faith, and so he is an elder. But then a second term that we see in the elders, a little bit later he says, I exhort you. And Peter is exhorting him as a fellow elder, which is powerful. He could have said Peter as just an apostle, and he does that. Peter mentions his apostleship. I've witnessed Christ personally. I've seen his sufferings. But Peter says, I as a fellow elder am encouraging you, you elders, to shepherd the flock. Verse 2 is shepherd. The idea there is to feed, to nurture. Last week we had the elders stand, and I'm very thankful for them. I'm thankful that I don't have to pastor and shepherd alone. I'm thankful that I have other brothers. And we need to be in prayer for Tom Tikhonov and his wife, Kate. Tom had a son who died tragically at the end of this week. And so there in California, let's be praying for Pastor Tom as he's away from us. Very hard ordeal, passing of his son. And so let's be in prayer for Tom this week, if you would. But we see here that pastors, bishops, elders, all of them are functioning by leading the flock. Now, as we kind of sum up the sermon that we started last week, if you would, last week we noted the plurality of elders. Bottom of page 1, we talked about that there is a evidence of a first among equals, a pastor that leads the other pastors, and together they lead together the church. We talked about all of that. Notice bottom of page 2 in your notes, as Peter begins his final chapter in this epistle, I want us to notice just 4 big ideas about this direct instruction that Peter is giving to pastors. Number 1, this is a general appeal to all pastors. Certainly there's a sense in which this was a special appeal made to the pastors of those that were serving the church in Asia Minor in Peter's day. But there's another sense in which this is rightly applied to all pastors of all New Testament gospel-preaching, Bible-believing, gospel-loyal pastors. This would be appropriate for all churches and all pastors of all churches that preach and live the gospel. We noted last week that Peter is making this exhortation as a fellow elder. He is a fellow elder. Notice page 3, we've got little pictures there. Peter is really concerned that as elders, and then we see it in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, Paul says, those of you that are in elders, those of you that are discipling, please make sure that you teach others who will pass it on. So there's this great, number 1, an appeal to all elders that we not drop the baton. Peter's making this appeal as a fellow elder, but letter B, he's making it as an apostle because he witnessed personally the sufferings of Christ. Number 2, and we've already mentioned this, but number 2, here Peter reminds these pastors their job. What is their job description? So number 2, their job description. Peter wants to make sure that the main portion of the pastor's job is clear in their mind. Let me just stop here and say this. Like, if you're coming to Southeast Valley Bible Church hoping that the pastors are going to entertain you, I'm just going to say you're in the wrong church. Like, we're just not wired for entertainment. And so, like, I've said this before, my face is perfect for radio as opposed to TV. And thank you, number 3. That was most kind. And there are some churches that have this idea that the pastor's job is to somehow better market their church over against other churches. Wait, everybody look up here. We don't care about that here at Southeast Valley. We're not trying to be the cooler church. That's in no way, shape, or form captures the spirit of what Peter is saying, and it doesn't capture the rest of the New Testament as well. And we have a job to do. We share the gospel with the lost, and we disciple believers, and we fellowship together, and we encourage one another. We identify spiritual gifts in one another. We encourage people to use those gifts, and we allow them to lead gifts. And so that's really what our job is. We are to function as we just said, a presbyter, an elder. We're to function as an overseer. And by the way, you'll notice in your notes, point number two, an elder, this is one who's experienced. He knows how to lead others. Number two, a bishop and an overseer, this is one who acts as a guardian or a superintendent. So a pastor is to oversee. He has a bishop responsibility. And then number three, he feeds, he leads, he protects. That is to say, he shepherds. I'd like for us to kind of conclude our sermon that we started last week by looking at these last two points. Notice number three. If you're going to follow the call to be a pastor, and I would even say that a lot of this in spirit applies to those of you that want to serve as a deacon. If you really feel that God has called you to be a shepherd, a pastor, or even a deacon, a lot of this idea of serving Christ, and by the way, it's not just pastors and deacons, it's for the entire congregation. However, in whatever way we serve the Lord together in ministry, this is not for the praise and glory of you. This is not so that people can say, look at how great you are. No, this is for the praise and the glory of God. We want to honor God, and we want to make sure that God is glorified by what happens in our ministry. It's not wrong for us to say thank you to the talented musicians that we have. This morning, the choir before church met. It was fun to hear the choir. They're back. The choir loft was full. And so when the choir sings and our musicians lead us and other people serve in various capacities, is it wrong for us to say thank you? No, it's right to say thank you, right? It's right for us to say thank you to those that are helping in ministries that we don't even see, like the nursery workers. When was the last time you or I said, hey, thank you, you work in the nursery? Those that work in the very back, the sound booth. Yeah, some of us who have... Anytime the sound goes off or there's a glitch, some of us that have turned back and given them the evil eye, we've actually never said thank you. And so it would probably be more important for us to say thank you than it, by the way, just to let you know, when the sound goes off or the thing, they actually know. And like, you actually don't have to give them the eye. I mean, they got the memo. And so they don't need 183 people staring back at them. That's like the last thing they need. You guys can get me a Coke later, so that's make it a Diet Coke. At any rate, zero sugar. So we see here a call to motive. No matter which way you serve, there's a special kind of motive that he includes. Notice verse 2, the last part of verse 2. We're serving as overseers, not by compulsion. Okay, that first one is, okay, so like that one is, man, and the application of that one is all over the map. We said last week, it's wrong for people to go into ministry or to go into missionary work because they were called by maybe their parents or their grandparents. No, people going into ministry should not go into ministry by compulsion. That's especially true if like in the church of the living God where you happen to live is suffering persecution. By the way, let me say this. My guess is in Afghanistan, church leadership program in Afghanistan, they probably don't wait for you to be 50 before they enlist people into ministry leadership. Why? Well, the 30-year-olds in leadership now, they may not be in leadership a month from now. They may be in heaven a month from now. And so as we're listening to Peter talk to the early church, we need to remember, I mean, they had already gone through seasons of persecution. They're just a year or two away from serious persecution under Nero. Persecution is about ready to bust out of the seams all over Asia Minor. And so there's a reason why it's okay. Timothy is probably in his 30s, and he maybe not be as an olded, bearded man as what we're used to in the context of Israel. But it's okay that we have young people in their 20s and 30s and 40s that are not 50, 60, or 70. It's actually God's plan for younger people in their 20s and 30s to say, hey, I believe God is calling me into ministry. I'm going to aspire to the office of deacon or elder. And it could very well be that you're listening to my voice and the Lord has been speaking to your spirit and you actually have this growing conviction that God wants you to be doing more. I would say don't try to get in a race with God. Jonah tried. He didn't win, right? And Elijah tried, and he didn't win. I mean, the list is, I mean, we can look in Scripture at people that tried to outrun the call of God in your life. And so as God calls us to serve, we got to make sure that our motive is right. Bottom of page 3, or I'm sorry, top of page 4 in your notes, if you wouldn't notice page 4, we have the rest of these motives. What are some of the right motives as it relates to serving as a pastor, elder, bishop, as it relates to even serving other offices, deacon, those that will serve in the Christ in the church of the living God? Letter B, seeking God's will, not man's will. That's very clear as we get here. We serve as overseers not by compulsion, but willingly. We're willing to serve willingly based on God's will, not just our will. Notice letter C, it's not based on self-centered greed. As noted by Peter elsewhere, the motivation of serving as a pastor is bringing glory to Christ and bringing clarity, encouragement, and help to our Lord's sheep. In 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 3, Paul explains that one of the important characteristics of the man of God is that he not be gripped by the love of money. The Holman translation calls it not greedy. So those of you that grew up with the King James, like filthy lucre. I actually like the King James translation on that. I think that's good. Filthy Luther. Our motive, we're not seeking God's will, we're seeking man's will. Our motive, we're not doing ministry based on self-centered greed. Our motive, we're not domineering. Like, this isn't the Joel show. This is not the pastor show. This is not the church of the pastor. I mean, I'm not even the chief shepherd. Jesus of Nazareth is to be preeminent in the church, not the pastor or the team of pastors. And so certainly they should not be domineering. By the way, not only is not domineering the way that pastors should not respond to the church, husbands, fathers, God has given you a responsibility to lead your home, but you're not to lord it over your wife. You're not to lord it over your children. So in the same way that a pastor is to be a humble leader by way of example, then a husband and a father is a loving leader by way of example, not being Godzilla to your family, not overusing your authority and abusing your authority. We talked a little bit about that in Sunday school. So not being domineering. There is a legitimate authority the pastor has within your life. There is a portion of your life that falls outside the role of your pastor's authority, such as issues dealing with Christian liberty choices. Say, well, Joel, if you're the pastor, why would you tell me this? Well, in case I forget, remind me. If I get into the weeds of your life and I wrongly begin to demand that you follow my Christian liberty choices instead of your Christian liberty choices, you're able to say, Pastor Joel, you're outstepping your pastoral authority. I'm also telling you this because as hard as it is for me to admit it, it may very well be in the providence of God, the Lord's going to move you sometime and you'll be looking for another church and another pastor. It's going to be imperative that you not go to a church that has a pastor that is abusive with his authority. If there's a church that has a pastor who's abusive of their authority, don't stay there. Get out. That's not the kind of church that you want to be in. So pastors are not to be domineering, lording it over. I'll give you an illustration. A few years ago, there was a rash of college students in a nearby ministry that began to ignore the interaction of godly parents because pastoral staff members were teaching them that they needed to leave their parents and cleave to their wife. These leaders were essentially saying, you need to trust us, your pastors, to give you the best advice, not your parents. That is correct if after the marriage, parents are selfishly demanding of their grown married children that they do exactly what they want them to do now that they're married. In most cases, that's not what was happening. What was being said is that the college student should set up boundaries. The problem of this were several fold. A large struggle was that these students, many of whom were still living at home, still dependent upon parents paying bills, insurance, gas for vehicles, wanted their cake and eat it too. B, biblically, until you're paying your own bills, you don't clip yourself from your parents' boundaries. So young people, you want your own freedom? Pay your own bills, then you get freedom. That's how that works. Say, well, I didn't like that. Well, I don't care. You need to hear it. Okay? You want freedom and you want authority to make your... So here's the deal. If you want freedom to, you know, make individual adult, Christian adult decisions, then be an individual Christian adult and pay your own bills and make your own way. Otherwise, you have a biblical responsibility. And it's okay for you to make decisions and to do things maybe differently than your parents do, but you don't have to be you don't need to dishonor them. There's no way in which that is right. Christian pastors causing division within a family is an example of lording it over. I'm giving you an example of ways Christian pastors violate Christian families by lording it over. When a Christian pastor inserts his authority wrongly into the personal decisions of a family. Now, if a Christian family, if you're a member at Southeast Valley Bible Church and I, as your pastor, see that you're violating your role as a leader within your family, we're going to have a conversation. Because that's my right as a pastor. I see it's my job to help disciple you. But when you're talking about individual decisions and individual Christian liberty choices that an individual Christian family can make, that's not, I can give you my suggestion, but at the end of the day, I got to be careful not to violate my role as pastor. So that's just one way. There's all kinds of other examples I can give you of not lording it over. Lastly, number four, the last instruction for pastors is an encouragement for reward. So Peter's going to say this, hey, listen, it's going to be tough, and I need you to lead, I need you to love, I need you to listen, I need you to be an encourager, I need you to be an overseer, you need to lead, you need to feed, you need to guard, you need to protect the sheep against the wolves, and just know that at the end of all of that, there's an encouragement for reward. Because I got to tell you, being a pastor, there are great days, but there are times being a pastor, it can be exhausting. It can be thoroughly exhausting. And we in the Church of America, we don't know anything about the type of intense persecution that these believers were experiencing or were about to experience. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 4, and when, this is finally, Peter's giving some encouragement. Pastor, be encouraged that when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Peter doesn't explain, point number four in your notes, Peter doesn't explain what this award is, but there is some kind of a crown of glory given to faithful pastors. Peter uses language consistent with the kind of reward passed out during games similar to the Olympics in ancient Greece. Paul makes it clear that there is a connection between heavenly reward and our discipline. I love 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win. Everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. By the way, you can't serve the church of the living God. You can't serve others and you can't lead others if you can't even lead yourself by submitting to the Spirit of God in your life through self-control. So they do it to obtain a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. Therefore, I run in such a way not to run aimlessly. I box in such a way to avoid hitting the air, but I strictly discipline my body and make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified. And then by way of conclusion, verse 5, the entire congregation should follow the leadership of the eldership. Verse 5, he concludes, hey, listen, you follow your leaders, but especially those of you that are younger, be teachable in your spirit. Understand that there's a reason why the Lord has placed the people in your life that he has. Well, I pray that it's been an encouragement for you to be in the church of the Lord today. We've had a great Sunday school. We've had a great time of fellowship. And I pray that the reading of 1 Peter has been a blessing to you. I want to give us our benediction out of order. I want to give us our benediction, and then I'm going to ask the musicians to come and close us in the service. This comes from Jude, verse 24. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory in majesty and dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen.
The promised land.
dismissed. Please fellowship together.